Ross, I saw a bit of conflicting reports about what's going on there. How are ground troops now being involved in all of this?
Well, that's right. Initially, there was the suggestion that ground troops had actually gone into the Gaza Strip. What they are doing is involved in the aerial fire. So there's a combination of aircraft, tank and artillery fire coming into Gaza, another very heavy barrage overnight from the Israeli side. There is, of course, the possibility that ground troops could yet go in. The military said that they've been authorized to call up another 9,000 reservists, and they are looking at scenarios, of course, that would include a possible ground incursion, but currently they're not doing so. That said, there's been a pretty big barrage of artillery fire into Gaza overnight, at the same time, of course, rocket fire coming back from Hamas the other way.
Well, yeah, inside Israel itself, the violence there doesn't seem to be showing any signs of slowing down either. What do we know about inside Israel?
Well, that's right. And in some ways, that's potentially more worrying, because even if you get to the point that Hamas and the Israeli government agree to a ceasefire, how do you get people to stop fighting in the way that they are in the streets in Israel? You've got very, very serious communal strife. Of course, that is like very, very deeply unresolved conflicts that have gone on for many years with Arabs and Jews who've been living very closely next to each other. And now you've got a series of violence, including shootings, of course, synagogues being burnt, people being attacked, and getting that to stop could in fact be the harder thing.
There's going to be another UN Security Council meeting, Ross. I want to get a sense from you on what's going on within the Biden administration. There's an envoy to Libya appointed, but there hasn't been an envoy to Israel. There's not even an ambassador to Israel. Why?
Well, that's right. Some of the Biden administration appointments, of course, around the world have been pretty slow to get through, not just with the Middle East. But Joe Biden has had some pretty big initial priorities possibly elsewhere. Of course, he's been dealing with Russia. He's been dealing with China. That's a very big one. He's been trying to get the Iranian nuclear deal back to the table and grappling with a huge crisis at home with the pandemic. So some of his appointments have been slowed down, and he perhaps didn't see the Israeli thing as an immediate priority until, of course, it did blow up.
What does this mean, Ross, for the Abraham Accords, which was done under the Trump administration, but something that was hailed by Biden as well when he was campaigning?
Well, there'll be a deep sense of anxiety amongst all the parties not to have this cause serious long-term problems for the Abraham Accords. Of course, that's the thaw that we're seeing between Israel and Gulf Arab states, and that's potentially going to bring enormous dividends to everybody in the region, including economically and with trade and investment, just the opening of borders and aviation and so on. So there's a very, very strong interest to not have that happen. But what could happen is that the implementation of the Accords could slow down. So the opening up that we're seeing on that could slow down as a result, that you do see a strong desire to make sure that the actual accords themselves are preserved.